The Pythagorean theorem is probably the most useful thing in the world. I use it to make games, location-based systems, augmented reality apps, machine learning projects, but also to build things in the real world, like this swing. Really, if something is more useful than this, I would like to know what that is. So today, I'll teach you what the Pythagorean theorem is, how to prove it's true, how I use it in practice, and how to implement it in JavaScript. Let's begin. The Pythagorean theorem applies to right triangles like this one. It states that a squared plus b squared is equal to c squared, where a and b are the lengths of these two sides coming from the right angle, and c is this other one, also called the hypotenuse. Now, what does this mean, really? Well, a squared is the surface area of this square, right? And b squared is the area of this other square. The theorem says that adding those two squares together is the same as the area of c squared. And it's true. Look, if I cut this square like this and move these pieces around, they fit perfectly. But that's not all. This statement is true for any right triangle. This dissection-based proof was invented by Henry Perigal in 1872. I found it interesting, so I decided to make it interactive. Check it out, I'll link it in the description. There are over 300 proofs for the Pythagorean theorem. The first was discovered by Pythagoras, or one of his followers, somewhere around the year 500 BC. But the relationship was known centuries before that. Now, if I convinced you that the theorem is true with the visual proof alone, you can skip ahead to the applications. But if not, let's look at the more rigorous proof by Albert Einstein. Before we begin, a quick reminder that these two angles, whatever they are, must add up to 90 degrees. This is true because if I draw a line here, parallel to the base, all angles can be found here as well, adding up to 180 degrees. One of them is 90 degrees, so the other two must add up to 90 as well. Now, Einstein drew this perpendicular line here to create two right triangles. Both these right triangles share another angle with the original one. That means that we know these angles here as well, because of what I reminded you earlier. This also means that all these triangles are similar to each other. The hypotenuse of the orange triangle is A. I'm going to draw it here for more clarity. The hypotenuse of the blue triangle is B. I'll draw this one here as well. And the hypotenuse of the original triangle is C. Now, this relationship is obviously true, that the area of the orange triangle plus the area of the blue triangle equals the area of the original triangle. It is also true that these triangles are all scaled versions of themselves, and the area of the middle one, for example, is equal to the area of the smallest one multiplied by the scaling factor squared. We get the scaling factor from the ratio of the hypotenuses, and squaring is necessary when dealing with areas. We can do the same for the area of the largest triangle, to rewrite this equation relative only to the smallest triangle, which we can then simplify to get this. Final step is to multiply by a squared, and we find exactly what we're looking for. Now, you may be wondering, didn't Einstein do some more serious things than this? And he did, eventually, but this is what he was doing when he was 12. Okay, great. We are now pretty confident that this is true. But so what? This doesn't look pretty useful as such. I mean, how often do you have to work with squares in this way? And the truth is, you don't. At least, I don't. But what I really need in almost every one of my projects is to calculate the distance between two points, knowing their coordinates. So let's write a function called distance that has two points as parameters. I first need to find a and b by calculating the difference on the x and y axes. Then I can use the Pythagorean theorem to get c squared, and then I take the square root of that to get the distance, c. Now, to write it more proper, you should take the absolute value of the difference here. But because these values are squared anyway, it doesn't matter, so we can leave it as such, and the code is also more efficient in this way. To test it, I made this simple app where we have two characters and the distance between them in pixels. We can move these characters around to see how the distance changes. When the distance is less than 42 pixels, the characters touch each other. This is an example of a very basic collision detection that you could use in some game. Here, I'll make it so that something happens when the characters touch. You can play with this simple demo on my CodePen. Check it out in the description. Now you know the basics. It's time to go pro. Here are some tips. First, instead of using the square root function here, change it to math.hypot, which is pretty much the same, but it also handles overflow and underflow problems if the numbers are very large. Tip number two. You can actually work with squared values here. I lied previously when I said I don't. You just leave out the square root here, but then you need to compare with the square of the value. The behavior is exactly the same, but in this way, the code is faster because the square root is slower to compute than a simple multiplication. Tip number three is practice. You won't learn if you're just looking at videos like this. So I made a game where you type code as fast as possible and without making mistakes. The faster you type, the more the cyclist will accelerate, and the further you'll reach. Hope you learned something today, and if you did, please like this video and subscribe if you want to see more things like this in the future.